Like me, have you ever walked along a wild river carrying a real heavy pack, watching the water flow effortlessly down the valley? Have you thought how good it would be to float downstream, letting the water carry the weight of that pack? Recently on the Dusky Track, I thought just this, as we followed the beautiful Seaforth River down to Supper Cove. When we reached Dusky Sound, we got wet as we waded up to waist deep most of the way to the hut. I think this is the time I decided to give packrafting a go. The concept of carrying a light blow-up raft and then being able to float downstream with the flow seemed very appealing. Little did I know there were more advantages than just easy downstream travel. The views are always open and the tops of the mountains are generally more visible from the river, unlike on a track only a few meters away in the neighboring bush. The first and last day of the Hollyford in particular showed us this. So, research led me to PackraftingNZ and owner guide Arno, based in Tiarnow. He had what looked like an awesome trip, 2 days training followed by 5 days to do the Hollyford Pyke Loop, which is now recognised as one of the premium packrafting routes in the world. This Y-shaped river arrangement, by a quirk of geography, lets you paddle most of the way downstream to within 20k or so of where you start. Arno is an absolutely awesome teacher and guide, fueled by an absolute passion for packrafting. He led us through 2 days of safety and paddle techniques on local lakes and rivers before we hit the Hollyford, blessed with great weather and tailwinds all the way. I really can't recommend this trip highly enough, so give it a go if you think packrafting might float your boat. The 150km 5-day Hollyford Pyke Loop starts at the Hollyford Road end. The view here shows the packrafting sections in blue and the tramping sections in red. On day one, after a half-hour walk to the put-in, we set off down the Hollyford River. The top section has most of the trees and short sections of rapids, usually all below grade 2. The river weaves its way down the generally straight and wide Hollyford Valley, with the imposing wall of the Darrens on the left side throughout. There is one short section of portage to avoid the class 3 or 4 rapids shown in red here, before we jump back on the river down towards the confluence with the Pyke. The river then turns west before heading north again towards Makero Island Hut for our first night after some 27 kilometres of paddling. Day 2 started in the dark and we paddled for an hour or so before dawn, making our way along the 15.5 kilometre Lake Makero with a very helpful strong tailwind. At the top of the lake, we awaited the turn of the tide before paddling the remaining 7 or so kilometres to the wonderful and beautifully located Martin's Bay Hut. The storms a couple of years ago have changed the geography around here, and the river now joins the sea 2.5 kilometres before the hut, creating a lagoon for the last section of the day's paddle. For day 3, we transitioned to tramping, carrying our 20kg packs for 13 kilometres around the coast of Big Bay Hut. The rocky headland and high tide route around Long Reef traverses the most difficult terrain of the trip, as the muddy path passes through dense west coast bush before hitting the rocky shingle beach along the coast. The final treat of the day once we hit the sand of 3 Mile Beach is a quick refreshing dip in the ocean before we reach the somewhat oversubscribed hut for the night. Day 4 starts with a 13km level hike on a good track through more dense west coast bush to reach the Pyke River put-in, where we transition back to the pack rafts. For us, the Pyke River was the most beautiful section of the trip. The river flows south and crosses 2 lakes, the first of which is Lake Wilmot, which is just 2 kilometres to cross. More trees and rapids add interest on the next section to Olivine Hut, where we stopped for lunch. We then set off on the penultimate paddle leg down towards Lake Alabaster, stopping off to meet Bruce, who lives along this section along the way. Fueled by Bruce's coffee, we headed onward for the 6.5 kilometre crossing over the lake to the hut at the south end. For our final day, we transitioned again to walking with slightly lighter loads now for the 21 kilometres back up the Hollyford Valley. This section is reasonably flat with only little Homer saddle to cross at a lofty 143 metres. After Hidden Falls Hut and the impressive somewhat Hidden Falls, the track then follows the river for a while before leaving it for 4 kilometres until just before the road end again. 150 kilometres completed and smiles all around from our team of 5. So, we start the trip at Arno's base, staying on site in his new glamping facility for our initial 2 days of training.
Campsite at the Packraft base. Pretty nice spot. Beautiful view. Glamping.
It's not what it used to be.
Glamping.
Glamping. It's an intense experience.
It's quite hot in here when it's hot. It's quite cold in here when it's cold. That's my observation.
Well, it's a bit of a blank canvas.
But a very nice setup here. Arno's got. Ooh! A beautiful view.
Saturday, practicing.
Right, as a group. You're still getting a lot of hair wet when you're falling in.
Alright.
So the one thing you want is, but it's the finer detail, is when you fall in, slide out of your boat rather than your own head down. Because what we really want to do is protect our head. So when you give the assistance, right, the easiest is you park yourself in the way that the pedals are in the front. Because that way they're not in the way where people want to sit.
Day two on the Wairau. Tony's chilling out. Had enough for today, Tony? Done most of the rapids, just one wee one to go for our last training day on the Wairau River. Yes, we have to go backwards through the biggest rapid on the river. Awesome. What could go wrong? Beautiful day. Doing about two lots of 3 hours, two runs, lots of laps, lots of training. Pretty cool. A few falls in the river. Getting out again before we start our expo tomorrow. Here we have Tim trying to get everything in there. Is it going to fit?
Find out. Could be awkward if it doesn't.
You've still got to get all that in and that in there. The start of Hollyford Exped. Hollyford Pyke. Just leaving the cars. Loaded up. 20 kgs each, approximately. Ready to go. Tim giving it loads, blowing it up. Pretty easy, 10 to 15 of those. And she's good to go. little flick of the wrist. awesome.
Put in point in the Hollyford.
Day one, the day's first victim. Just down that rapid over there.
Beautiful.
How you doing, John?
Oh, good, mate. How are you?
Good.
Looking very blue.
I am very blue. I'm very blue underneath as well. Oh. But I'm not blue in my hat.
Right. Isn't it traditional you fart about now, Tony?
There's Tony relaxing in the boat on the Hollyford River. Lots of fallen trees here. It's a bit interesting. Nice seeing little ice sheets up there. About halfway through the first day, and we've got to this infamous class 4 rapid. Can't really see what's going on, but lots of big rocks and menacing water rushing noises, so we've got to stay away from it.
This is the portage section to avoid these rapids. Class 4 downstream, apparently. And we head up and around for a wee way. This part of the portage, it's a slick end. I'm going to carry it. Swimming so far. Everyone but me. There's still time. It's the Pyke River coming in. Head off to the left.
Carrow Island hut, just at the foot of Lake Macquarie. We have arrived. Lake Macquarie that we'll be crossing or going along tomorrow. Fairly long lake, as you can see. Track down to the Hollyford River where we disembarked up to the hut. Cool ferns everywhere, very Jurassic Park. Back up the Hollyford. Got a beach with deer, obviously. Just before 6. Ready for our early morning start across Lake Macquarie, which is probably invisible on the camera. Nice tailwind. A little bit before high tide, this is just where seawater meets the lake, an impasse, so we will probably wait on the beach for about an hour until it's high tide.
And this is at the end of Lake Macquarie. Just been waiting here for about half an hour, like 40 minutes actually, waiting for the tides to change. As you can see all those waves there, that is the tidal waters coming in, emerging with the lake winds. So there's a lot of, you know, waves on the lake, and then they break when they hit the incoming tide. And that should be about to stop and change. Should be changing tide in just a few minutes. There's Arno, our guide. Everyone else is just chilling out on the beach, out of the wind.
Shell duck.
Sorry?
Shell duck.
Shell.
I don't normally see them in a big group.
There's a lot of couples together.
Yeah.
Young there.
So we've just passed the mouth of the Hollyford River and are drifting into this little lagoon. There's quite a few batches around here. 25 feet of them. So that's the lagoon up there.
Just hanging in St. Martin's Bay, still going the right way, little breeze. Oh, maybe I'm stopped. Lagoon. St. Martin's Bay Hut. There used to be a river through there, which is now blocked by a storm. Cool view from the hut, down the sand spit. Nice sunny day to try the gear. Sunny outlook near Martin's Bay Hut. Stunning Martin's Bay Beach. End of day two on our pack rafting trip. First day down the Hollyford to the McKerrow Island hut. 6 hours or so, I think, paddling that day. And then today, up at 6 a.m, depart from the boat and arrive here at 1 this afternoon. It's just a simply stunning location. After what we've come here. Day two, 3 more days to go around the big bay, which is all walking day tomorrow, around the headland and then across the beach, then into the Pyke River, 13k walk, and then paddle down the pike for the last big day out, the last 2 days of the big days. But this is just absolutely stunning, apart from the sun.
just leaving Martin's Bay in the morning.
Beautiful morning.
Yeah.
Yes, plenty of that in this track. High tide, root around. It's a big bay. Dense flax and mud. Be thinning out a wee bit now. Apparently it's good for you.
It's good for you.
Good. Mud. Glorious mud. Nothing quite like it for cooling the blood. Yes. They're in the penguin colony now. And we should get onto Big Bay Beach itself shortly after. Into Big Bay. Go for it, yo!
Big Bay day 3, and one of the locals who just flew in, he's got to fly back to his town, Hope and Arrow town. Pretty cool lifestyle. well now.
Seven, about to leave Big Bay. The Pyke River, apparently, like this. 13k for the day to the river. Beautiful. Nearing the pike now, half an hour or so, to the river. Beautiful section, the trees and the old forest. Here we are, the pike. As Arno succinctly says, all we need to do is now find a river with enough flow to Packraft. And then 6 or 7 hours down the pike to through two lakes. Second one is Alabaster. First one I've forgotten, Wilmot I think. Fairly long paddling down to Alabaster Hut. Stopping at Olivine Hut. 3 p.m. all being well. See if we can find a river. By definition, I'm not taking videos when we go through the little rapids. So it's just the cruisy sections. Nice and northerly. She doesn't
stop this boat swinging around.
Hut. Finally. Nice.
I read that, cases per capita, whatever it is.
Yeah.
I'm presenting.
How you going, John?
All good, mate. Nearly at Lake Alabaster. Can't wait for the hour and a half paddle across that.
It's going to be a fun paddle.
I think Pyke Valley wins the prize for the best bit. Beautiful valley. Darren's all lined up at the end of Lake Alabaster. Tudor Cove just in the cloud. Nearing the end of the lake now, half an hour or so to the hut. Just round the corner. Back up the Pyke Mountain. Lake Alabaster hut. The end of Lake Alabaster. Two to go. And Darren's across the other side of the Hollyford. Beautiful spot. Thank you very much, Arno. Good work, guiding us.
Very welcome.
Yeah.
Edits.
been an absolute pleasure.
Hidden Fool's Hut. Hidden Fool's Crossing. And at the end, Hollyford Road end, after a quick 5 hours and 21k, well, 6 hours including breaks. What a trip. What a trip.